Greetings, Church. I wanted to complete this video and at least try to complete it today before any more damage. Before any more damage is done here. As I've said before, my transcriber is not working, and it's not transcribing the things that I wanted to transcribe. Anyway. I'm going to go ahead and open in a word of prayer and just do the work. If it works, it works. If it doesn't, if it works, it works. If it doesn't, it does not. Don't ever buy a transcribing software for your computers, because you'll be wasting your money. You'll be wasting your money. You'll be wasting God's money, making a bad investment. Anyway, what we're going to talk about today is 2 Peter, chapter 3, verses 1 through 18. And as you know, I've been working on the Peter series for a while now. I'm going to go ahead and open in a word of prayer, and then I'll just go ahead and start with the passage of Scripture. Father, thank you for this hour. Thank you for an opportunity to preach your word, teach your word, to encourage the church. In Jesus' name, amen. This is the text that I have produced as a result of the First Peter and Second Peter, and as a result of First Peter and Second Peter, this is the text that I have produced, and it's not complete. I haven't filled in all the information on it yet, and. And so as I'm talking to you, I'm being hit on the transcriber, who is supposed to be recording everything that I'm saying, but the Americans are opposing the fact that I have a transcriber, and they will not let the transcriber type everything as if I was a European doing it. If I was a European doing it, then they probably allow the whole thing to just work perfectly and normal. But being that I'm of Haitian descent, and I didn't take their position in history, I took their position instead. I didn't like what those people did back in the day. I didn't like the fact that they came here and destroyed the lives of these people. And I thought that was a cheap shot. You know, I thought that was an evil thing to do. But, you know, you can't cry over spilled milk. And when the milk has been spilled, all you can do is get around it and wipe it up. You know, we came as slaves ourselves, and our families were divided. Some stayed up here in America, and others were taken down to the Caribbean. I'm from the Caribbean, and so it's one of those things that I don't think anybody's ever going to get over. The history of this country, the history of the American people, and how we became who we became. In any case, you know, I'm an angry Bible teacher, you know, and I'm an angry Bible teacher because people have been hurt, you know, lives have been taken, homes have been destroyed. When I watched that video, I had a pen and a piece of, I took 5 pages, more than 5, probably like 6-7 pages of information, right? Because I was so angry at what I read. And I'm like, you know what? I need to get I need to get a book that has all this information in it, because I couldn't keep up with the writing. So it took me like 3 hours to watch a 2-hour video. Anyway, getting back to Peter, I pray that God will bless just this few minutes that we have here to talk about his word. Peter, as you know, is an apostle from the New Testament times, and he was called the apostle with the first shake mouth. He was the apostle who stood with Christ, who walked with Christ, and lived lived in Israel with his brethren. When Peter had written his first epistle, it was to encourage the church. It was to encourage the church to basically endure persecution. Peter had had written this letter basically to encourage the church to stand firm and to stand tall and to continue living for God, no matter what they did, you know, no matter what they said, no matter what plot they came up with. You know, Peter's intention was to glorify God and to continue the work of Christ. Right? Peter's intention was to glorify God and continue the work of Christ. What else would be the reason for Peter to write these letters? He's only written two in the New Testament. When we first meet Peter, his only interest was in fishing, you know, going into the fishing industry and doing some fishing. He and his brothers, and John and his brothers. But when Christ came, Christ removed Peter and his brothers out of the fishing industry and says, I will make you fishers of men. So for many years, Peter was a preacher in Israel, and he preached the gospel to the people. But then there came a time when Peter had to encourage the church, right? The church in Israel and the church in Asia Minor. And we find that the church in Asia Minor is facing persecution because unbelievers were persecuting them and trying to draw them into back into the old life that they were living as unbelievers. And so Peter had to write them, and he addressed several different groups of people in his letter, right? He reminded them why they were Christians. They were scattered Christians throughout Galatia, Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, who were chosen. And he explains to them that they were chosen by the foreknowledge of God. In other words, God had chosen them in advance, knowing what he was going to do with their lives, that he was going to save them despite Roman opposition and slavery and so on and so forth. And he blesses God in his letter here, and he reminds the church, as if they were new Christians. He calls them babes. They're like newborn babes. They were to long for the pure milk of the word, so that by the word, they would grow in respect to salvation. He encourages the church to submit. He calls them precious stones, right? He calls them precious stones. He calls them to submission, submit to leaders, submit to those who are in authority over them. He calls them to submit to their masters, to submit to government. It's kind of hard to submit to government when government does stuff like this. How do you submit to a killing government? Right? How do you submit to a killing government? A government that shows no respect to the people. Right? A government that shows no respect to the people. A group of people declaring themselves a government. Were they not a government? Before those people came, were they not a government? They were a government. They were governing people, and they were not respected. But yet, Peter says to the church, those who are Christians, to respect government, to respect those that are masters over them. There was a time when these people were masters of themselves. They were not mastered by the white man, nor were we mastered by the white man, right? Nor were the Jews, Israel, mastered by the white man before the white man decided to leave his homeland to come to Africa, to go to Israel, right? And to come here to America. But yet, the Word of God tells you, you know, to trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not on your own understanding, in all your ways acknowledge Him, and He'll make your path straight. You know, we declared ourselves a government at one point. They declared themselves a government. The Jews were given their own government and system, right? So Peter, in the context of the Roman Empire, Peter, in the context of the Roman Empire, having taken over the entire, all the tribes around the Mediterranean, within that context, and a greater context is God being over all the nations, including the Roman Empire, and having control over every human life of that time. Peter tells them with full faith he urges them as aliens and strangers to abstain from fleshly lusts which wage war. He didn't tell them pick up guns and to go fight the empire. He didn't tell them to pick up guns and go fight their masters. He says, servants, be submissive to your own masters, right? He says, submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether to a king as one in authority or to governors as sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and the praise of those who do right. So Christians were called to a different standard. Why are we called to a different standard? Because we know the real King of Kings. We know the real Lord of Lords. We know God. We know God. On this level, we would tell them, you better fight for your country. On this level, we would tell them to submit to government. Which government? Their own government? The church's government? Right? The church's government? God's government? We find in Scripture. That is the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and the Scriptures. Or the European government that invaded them. Right? Which form of government? If you're the believer, you would submit to a church government. But you also have to respect the world's government, because we're not in the world, nor are we of the world. We're of the Lord and His Holy Spirit. So, in the first letter, Peter basically encourages the church of Asia Minor to submit to government. He tells wives to submit to their husbands, and husbands are to love their wives and live with them in an understanding way. He tells the church to, he says, to, talking to all of them, he says to they need to be sympathetic, brotherly, kind-hearted, and humble in spirit, not returning evil for evil. To the church, you can say that, but to them, oh no, they have to defend their country, and they have to defend their leaders. Because they didn't come out on this level, they came out on the national level, which is what everybody does. When we come out on the national level, we fight. But on the church level, it's Christ who is the head of us. And Christ who is the head of the church. We don't get into the squabbles of the nations, but we can sympathize with the nation, but we don't get into the squabbles of the nations. Because we've renounced the world. We've renounced the world, we've renounced the land, we've renounced our families. When we come to Christ, there is no land issue. When we come to Christ, there is no family issue. There is no government issue. Why is that? Because Christ is the head of all governments. Christ is the head of all lands. Christ is the head of all men, nations, tribes, and tongues. I and the Father are one, he says. Because of who he is, You know, because of who he is, we don't challenge his authority. Right? Because of who he is, we don't challenge his authority. Because of the life that he lived, we don't challenge his authority. Right? We don't challenge him because that's who he is all the time, at all times. And so we renounce the world, and we renounce government, we renounce land, family, you know, and choose Christ. You know, Peter says that they're going to be suffering. You know, Christians, he prepares them for suffering. And he says to them, if you suffer for the sake of righteousness, you are blessed. And do not fear their intimidation, and do not be troubled. But sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts, always being ready to make a defense to everyone who asks you to give an account for the hope that is in you, yet with gentleness and reverence, and keep a good conscience, so that in the thing in which you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. So we are told by Peter in this letter to sanctify Christ as Lord. Renounce the world. Why? Because the world is passing away, and all, and also its lust. All of the stuff that is in the world. Just, why? Because we're not staying. We're just passing through. So don't hold on to it. Let it go. Move on. You know? So Peter said, when we suffer, suffer as a Christian. Right? Suffer as a Christian. Don't suffer as a sinner who's going to do evil and then for God to come down and judge. There's a greater issue at hand. A greater issue. And the issue is our relationship with our Creator. That's the greatest issue. The greatest issue of all is our relationship with our Creator. That's the greatest issue of all. The greatest issue is the issue of us going to hell and leaving this world behind. The greatest issue is us going to hell, man burning in hell, because man did not do what? Did not recognize God for who he was and humble himself before. So, you know, in Paul's letter to the Church of Rome, Paul says what? Paul says that we've been turned over to a life of sin as a result of this, because we didn't deal with our issue with God. So Peter, knowing all of this, writes a letter. He reminds the Christian of their suffering. And he tells them, don't suffer as a criminal, but suffer as what? As a Christian. And he tells them to stand in the grace of God. And then we come over to Peter's second letter. And in his second letter, he talks to the Christians again in Asia Minor. This is the second letter to them, same group. And he says to them in the second letter, he talks to the Christians that are growing, and he tells them to keep growing. And then to the Christians that are not growing, he tells them, make sure, he says in verse 10, be all the more diligent to make certain about his calling and choosing you. For as long as you practice these things, you will never stumble. In other words, make sure that you're born again. Make sure that the Holy Spirit is in you. Make sure that you are children of God. Make sure that you are children of the living God, because if you're not, you're going to burn in hell. You see, he doesn't address their financial issues, right? Are you poor? Are you rich? Are you living in a high home? Do you own a lot of land? Are you gay? Are you straight? Nah. What is he talking about? He's talking about their relationship with God. That's more important. Are you tall? Are you short? Are you black? Are you white? No, he doesn't address those issues. He addressed the issues of faith, believing that there is a Creator who created every single one of us, and that Creator has an issue with us, and that issue is our salvation and his forgiveness. You know, we didn't go to him. He came to us, and he says, hey, I have an issue with you people. And that issue that I have with you people down there is that you're all sinners. It's him who says, hey, you need to be sanctified. You need to be born again. Or else I'm going to have to cast you into hell. Hell, what's hell? We don't believe in hell. You don't believe in hell because you haven't been there yet. So Peter basically is ready to remind these people, you know, in Asia Minor of all of this stuff. And so in chapter 2, he reminds them, before we go to chapter 2, in chapter 1, he reminds them of Scripture. And he affirms, and he reminds them of the fact that he was one of the apostles who had seen Christ and who has heard the word of God, the Father, on the Mount of Transfiguration. He was one of the apostles who was there. He was an eyewitness. And he was also one who touched the Christ, right? He was there, he saw what the Christ did. And when he heard the voice of the Father, he was more affirmed in his faith concerning what the prophets had written, right? He now understood how the prophets received the Scriptures, because they heard the voice of God, right? He heard, you know, he heard the word of God, but now when he read the Scriptures, he was more assured. After that experience, Peter didn't have a choice but to start reading. If fishing was his love, when he heard the word of God, when he heard the voice of God, and he heard the word of God, Peter just fell in love with the Old Testament. And Peter started reading the Old Testament as God's word. Why? Because he finally understood something. Peter understood now it wasn't just about fishing. Old Testament Israel wasn't just about fishing, right? Old Testament Israel, it's like, wait a minute, the Moses scriptures, the scriptures of Moses, the writings of the prophets, all of those books that was not of interest to Peter, after the Mount of Transfiguration experience, Peter started reading. He wanted to know. Scripture became important to him, right? And his own writing became Scripture. And Paul's writings became Scripture. Because he understood that God was talking to those Old Testament people through the prophets. And so it mattered to him. He says, no prophecy was ever made by an act of human will, but men moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. When he read the text, he now understood. He was shocked. Peter was shocked as to what was written in the Old Testament. That now he is suggesting, in his old age, he is suggesting to the Christians in Asia Minor, and he says to them, you don't understand. You know, these words were not spoken, you know, by an act of human will, but it was men moved by the Holy Spirit who spoke from God. Right? These Old Testament, I mean, wow. So he's now talking to the Christians in Asia Minor, and he's telling them, you don't understand, you need this book. You need the books of the prophets. You need the work of the Old Testament prophets. You need to read those texts. Right? He says to them, that's what he says to them here. And then in chapter 2, he says to them, oh, by the way, there's a warning coming. Because when he read the Old Testament, he read about false prophets. So he gives them a warning, and he says, there's something I have to tell you. False prophets also arose among the people. Now, how would he have known that? He would have known that by reading the Old Testament, right? That there were false prophets among the people, right? He would have known that by reading the Old Testament. Remember, he was a fisherman, and he went from fishing to what? To the position of the Pharisees, studying the Old Testament scriptures. So he took up the scriptures, now after reading the Christ, and who is he looking for in the Old Testament scriptures? The Christ. He begins to understand the Old Testament, and he's looking for the Christ in the Old Testament scriptures. And he says, remember Jesus says everything that was, in John 5:39, he says, everything that was written, let me read you John 5:39. In John 5:39, let me find that passage for you. My pulpit here is holding the camera, so I'm pulpitless. And looks like they removed the transcriber completely. I'm not exactly sure why, but we don't have anything being transcribed at this time. So in John 5:39, he says, you search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, and it is these that bear witness of me. So when Peter heard this, at first he was just like, you know, whatever. But then when Peter went into the Old Testament, what was he looking for? He was looking for the Christ because of that statement. And Jesus says, and you are unwilling to come to me that you may have life. Right? He says, I do not receive glory from men, but I know you that you do not have the love of God in yourselves. Right? And so on and so forth. But he says, so Peter warns the church in Asia Minor of false prophets. And then he says to them that false teachers are going to come among you. And they're going to introduce heresies, destructive heresies, to deny the master who bought them, bringing swift destruction upon themselves. So there's going to come a time when false teachers are going to come, and they're going to bring, condemning teaching. And he says to them, and he says that these people that are coming, their condemnation, he talks about their condemnation, right? Talks about their and then he talks about their characteristics. We covered this in the last time we taught on 2 Peter. Right, the kind of men that they were going to be. And he used examples. Right? He used examples of what these people were like. He talks about Noah. Noah, who was a righteous preacher. But yet his generation was unrighteous. He talks about Sodom and Gomorrah, right? And with Sodom and Gomorrah came Abraham and Lot. And Lot had to be rescued from all that. And he tells the church in Asia Minor, if God had delivered, you know, Lot from those things, and he had also preserved Noah. And he says, then the Lord knows how to rescue the godly, right, from temptation, and to keep the unrighteous under punishment, right, for the day of judgment. So basically, Peter is saying to them, look, you need the scriptures, right? In this second chapter, you Christians, stay strong. You Christians that are weak, that are about to lose your faith, pipe up. Get back into studying the Word of God, right? Get back into studying the Word of God, because now I'm more assured of the scriptures than I ever was before, because I've heard the voice of the Father. And I know that the prophets heard it too. And he says, and by the way, I read in the Old Testament that there were false prophets. So probably in the future sometime, there's going to be false teachers among you, introducing heresies. Let me tell you something about teaching the Bible. Bible teachers, Old Testament text scriptures, were challenged every day. Men who taught scripture, that's why James says, let not many of you become teachers, my brethren, for in doing so, you will be given a stricter judgment, right? You'll be given a stricter judgment. And it's not an easy task. It's not an easy job. And you know why it's not an easy task? Because it's a challenge to what we believe, whether we really believe this or not. Men from all nations and all tribes have been challenged by God in all kinds of ways, right? And the challenge that God poses is, do we really believe His word, even in the face of that kind of tragedy? Even in the face of that kind of travesty, African slavery, Native American losing their homes and their bodies and their families, the Jews, 6 million of them dying. So when the scripture says here that there are false teachers, teachers of the God of Abraham and of his word are going to be challenged. You know, the end result of chapter 2 was, you know what, they're going to be teaching a lot of stuff, but then they're going to be denying it. You know how many times I've been challenged by the American government to deny the faith? You know how many times I've been challenged by the gay community, the LGBT community, to deny the faith, to join them in sin, to join them in the very sin that they're known for, to take up the gun and to go after the government on those people's behalf. And losing my mind and how angry I get and pissed off at the fact that these people have lost their home. We are constantly challenged every single day of the year to go against this, to practice homosexuality and to commit murder, to love a man more than you can ever love a woman, to murder European people that are walking around here like sticks. And to give, and you know what? If you killed one a day for the rest of your life, it would be just for every Native American who died, for every African who died, and for every Jew who died by the hand of the Europeans in Germany and in America. But the Word of God calls us to something else. He called us to forgive. He calls us to repent. He calls us to remember that if we don't get a hold of Him and His Word, guess what's going to happen? We're going to go right back to the war. We're going to go right back to slavery. We're going to go right back to killing the Jews in Auschwitz, all of them, right? Auschwitz the Jews, hang the niggers, Negroes, whatever you want to call us, and annihilate these people. And there are good men who have struggled with these issues and have been condemned as false teachers because they couldn't hold their pants up. Because they couldn't keep their pants up for the men of the world. They couldn't keep their guns from shooting the government and the American people, the European people, right? For what they have done to Africans, for what they have done to Jews, for what they have done to other nations. And some people literally just throw out the book, and they throw out the teaching, and they throw out the God of Israel. But that's the challenge of the Christian faith. That's the challenge, is will you believe God in the face of atrocities? Right? Will you believe God in the face of murder? Will you believe God in the face of killing? Right? This is where your teaching is challenged. When you see the blood running from the mouth and the hands of the European people, will you still believe in Jesus as Lord and Savior and Messiah? After you watch this, will you still believe in a loving God? So, you know, the scripture says here that the false teachers, they're like a dog returning to its own vomit. I'm like a dog who returns to its own vomit. The whole of America knows that, right? So is my sin any different than this, the sin that was committed here? Me, full-blown in sin, and you, full-blown in sin, whether it be killing, taking off your clothes and dancing on a table, or videos, or murder, stealing, coveting. The whole purpose of Jesus coming and dying among us, it was for our sins. Whatever your sin, whatever format your sin takes, whatever format your sin takes, all of us like sheep have gone astray, and each of us have turned to his own way. But the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. False teaching or not, the challenge is there for us to believe in the Almighty God, right? So when it's all said and done, do I want to beat up the American people? You betcha. Do I want to really stick it to them every day? Do I want to bash them upside their head with my Bible? Oh, yes. Do I want to give it back to them for him? Oh, every single minute that I look at them, right? I want to give it back to them. But has God given it to me to do so? No, he gave me the better. He gave me his word. And he says, give them this. Because when I deal with them, I'm going to take that situation and put it in this context. And when I deal with slavery, I'm going to put it in this context. And when I deal with the 6 million Jew issue, I'm going to put it in this context. Everything you experience in life, church and state, he's going to put it in this context. Why? God has spoken, and no one is listening to him. So anyway, Peter writes this letter. He writes the first letter, encouraging the church to be strong, to submit, telling wives to submit, telling Christians to submit to one another. He writes this, the first letter, and encouraging them to, if you're going to suffer, suffer as a Christian. You know, don't go back into the world. And then he writes them a second letter, and he tells them in the second letter, you're going to, you know, he says, you Christians, stay Christian. And you Christians that are struggling and you're not sure, be sure that you are Christians. And then he says, as far as the Word of God is concerned, remember what I told you in the first letter, right? Like nursing babes long for the pure milk of the Word. Now, the second letter, he says to that, I am even more sure now that the writings of the writing of the prophets right? I am more sure now that the writing of the prophets were what? Where it was at. And then he warns them about false teachers. So this brings us to this right here, right? Peter's last 18 verses of Peter's second letter, which is 2 Peter 3:1-7. Derision, I'm using the outline that I found in this Bible here. It's the derision, which is mockery, shame, and laughing stock. 2 Peter 3:8-9, delay, hindrances, and lingering. 2 Peter 3:10-13, dissolution, which is destruction. And then 2 Peter 3:14-18, diligence, effort, and speed. So let's look at that real briefly here for the last few minutes that we have. So in derision, Peter writes and he says this, "This is now, beloved, the second letter I am writing to you, in which I am stirring up your sincere mind by way of reminder." Right? This is my second letter, and I'm basically stirring you up and reminding you. Now that he's talked about, now he's spoken to them as Christians, struggling Christians, the scriptures, false teachers. Now he says to them, "Now I'm writing to you to stir you up, to stir up your mind by way of reminder." Okay, so I'm writing. His speech has changed because, you know, he's now a scholar. He's of the Old Testament, and he's probably been hanging out with Paul, right? So they've had a lot of time to talk. So he says, by way of reminder, that you should remember the words spoken beforehand by the holy prophets and the commandment of the Lord and Savior spoken by your apostles. He says that you should remember the words spoken beforehand by the holy prophets, right? So he's writing them to remind them of the words that had been spoken by Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, and all the minor prophets, and the commandment of the Lord and Savior spoken by your apostles. So Peter now reminds them of both Old Testament writing of prophets and New Testament words that were spoken by Christ. And not only by Christ, but also by the apostles. So he's writing this letter to remind them of this, right? To warn them, to encourage them to keep walking in the faith, to be built up, to read the scriptures, warning them of false apostles, now reminding them of what? Of the holy prophets, the commandment of the Lord, and also by the words of the apostles. So then he says in verse 3, "Know this first of all, that in the last days mockers will come with their mocking, following after their own lusts." Right? Derision, mockery. So he warns them of false teachers, but then he says, "I got to warn you of something else, that there's going to be mockery. People are going to mock you. They're going to ridicule you." Right? He says, "Following after their own lusts, the desires of their own flesh and of their own mind," which is usually money, right? Sex, land, adultery, aggrandizement, you know, that sort of thing. And he says to them, these people are going to be following after their own lust. And in verse 4, he says, "And saying, where is the promise of his coming?" These people are going to be saying, "Oh, I thought you said Messiah was coming. Well, we don't see a Messiah coming," right? It says, for ever since the fathers fell asleep, all continues just as it was from the beginning of creation. Well, ever since the fathers, the prophets, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, right? And of course, the forefathers of the Christian faith, and also the apostolic fathers. Nothing has changed, right? Where is the promise of his coming, of his second coming, right? For ever since the fathers, apostolic fathers, prophetic fathers, all continues just as it was from the beginning of creation, right? He says, for when they maintain this, it escapes their notice that by the word of God, the heavens existed long ago, and the earth was formed out of water and by water. It says, for when they maintain this, when they maintain this position, they forget, right? It escapes their notice that by the word of God, the heavens existed long ago, right? It was by God's spoken word that the heavens existed, and the earth was formed out of water and by water, making reference to probably Genesis 1, right? verse 6, he says, through which the world at that time was destroyed, being flooded by one. Now making reference to Noah, the Noahic flood, right? Making reference to the Noahic flood. And remember, he had made reference to the Noahic flood in chapter 2 when he used, you know, you go back to chapter 2 and he says in verse 5, and did not spare the angels, or did not spare the ancient world, but preserved Noah, a preacher of righteousness, with seven others, when he brought a flood upon the world of the ungodly. He brought a flood upon the world of the ungodly. And now here he makes reference again to the Noahic flood. And he says to them, through which the world at that time was destroyed, being flooded with water. So these people are mocking. They're going to be ridiculing. False teachers are coming. And they're going to be asking. But what escapes their notice is what they're not even paying attention to, is that the word of God, what was spoken out of God's mouth, it was by God speaking that heaven came into existence. And the earth was formed, and water covered the earth. And that same water that covered the earth, and remember in Genesis, the scripture says that the Lord separated the waters from the waters. But then, it was that same water he brought back, right? The water that had covered the whole earth before he parted the waters and removed the water and separated the waters from the waters. It was like a big ball of water, right? And when the waters receded, the earth came forth. And when the earth came forth, right, we saw land. And then he reverted back to that position again in the Noah flood, right? He went back to before he called the earth forth. And so in verse 7, he says, but the present heavens and earth by his word are being reserved for fire, kept for the day of judgment and destruction of ungodly men. Look at what he says here. He says, but the present heavens and earth by his word are being reserved for fire. Again, by his word, by what was spoken out of his mouth. Verse 5, by the word of God, by what was spoken out of his mouth. Right? By his words are being reserved for fire. Because what did he say in the future? That there's going to be fire. Fiery judgment, where the world is going to be condemned, and the earth is going to be scorched. You can read that in Revelations. But it's being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of who? Of ungodly men. What ungodly men? False teachers. False prophets. False prophets in the Old Testament. False teachers. Sinners. Right? The sinners that he talks about in chapter 4. Those that are going to malign you. Those are the ungodly men he's talking about. Those that are going to persecute you. That's the ungodly. Those that, verse, chapter 4 of 1 Peter, he says, for the time already past is sufficient for you to have carried out the desires of the Gentiles. The ungodly men that he's talking about is the Gentiles, having pursued a course of sensuality, lust, drunkenness, carousals, drinking parties, and abominable idolatries. Those are the people that he's talking about. In our generation, it would be the butchers who did that to those people. And the unbelievers from among these people. And the unbelievers from among my people. And the unbelievers from among the Jewish people. And the unbelievers that are yet to come, who don't know anything yet about the God of Israel. So, those are the ungodly men that he's talking about here. It says, kept for the day of judgment and destruction of ungodly men. And then we want to switch over to delay. So we see the derision, the mockery, the shame, the laughing. They're going to be laughing, right? At the fact that I don't see no Jesus coming, right? But then he says, just remember, though, that there's destruction coming for those people. The same way there was destruction for those who laughed at Noah. So in the future, when they laugh, what they don't see coming is not water, but fire. But then there's a delay. A hindrance, a lingering, right? Sort of like I'm not sure if this is the right time to give it to them yet, you know, sort of like, he's holding it in, you know, he's holding it in. The sin has already been committed. But now, the difference between the sinners and the saints is that when we sin, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ, right? There's no condemnation for us because the blood of Christ cleanses us from all sins. So our faith and our hope is in what Christ did on the cross, right? So we're forgiven for that. But so there's a delay here, Peter says. He addressed the mockery, and then he says, but do not let this one fact escape your notice, Christians. Beloved, right, that with the Lord, one day is as a thousand years, and a thousand years as one day. Right? The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. The Lord is not as slow as you think. He's not as slow as you think. You think he's slow, but he's not. He's not being slow. He says, look at it this way. A thousand years for you is one day for the Lord. One day. So 2,000 years, 2 days. He's only been gone for 2 days, right? Two days. How many days was he in the belly of the earth? Maybe that's what it is. He's going to be gone for 2 days, 2 or 3 days. Maybe he'll come back in the middle of 3,000 years, 2.5, 2,500 years, and then he'll show up. I don't know, right? He died on Friday, and then he was buried on Friday, Saturday, Sunday he resurrected, Easter. I don't know, maybe that's what's going to happen with us upon his second coming. But he says here, the Lord is not slow about his promise, as some count slowness. Now, the ones that count slowness are the same ones that are mocking, and are the same ones that are called ungodly. Right? And he's talking about a future event here. And now, for the last 2,000 years, that's what's been happening. Remember, this was written in the first century. So for the last 2,000 years, men have been doubting, right? That he's not coming, he's not coming, he's not coming. And they've been mocking and ridiculing and poking fun at the church. Excuse me for a second. So, we see there's a delay, but Peter says, don't let this fact escape your notice, right? This is the second time he says, this is something that escapes their notice, but don't let this escape your notice. In other words, pay attention to the reality of God and to the reality of what God has and is doing. Don't be blindsided. Okay, they're blindsided by something, the God of creation, but you don't be blindsided by the time, right? Don't take the same position as them. You understand what happened here, but don't forget in Genesis 2:17, the scripture says, you shall surely die, right? Don't forget that in Genesis 2:17, the scripture says, you shall surely die. He didn't say how you're going to die, right? The story of Cain and Abel, the Europeans take the position of Cain, and these are the people that are able. They weren't paying any attention. It escaped their notice. And then they were caught off guard. Out of nowhere, Cain comes along and bang, 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 you know, stab, 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 take what is yours, and I'm out of here. But don't forget in the back of your mind, Christian, that God says, you shall surely die. Right? Lynching, you shall surely die. 6 million, you shall surely die. 900 African Americans under Jim Jones, you shall surely die. 9 African Americans in a church recently, the bomb that went off in the church, you shall surely die. Right? Earthquakes, fires, bombs, wars, World War I, World War II, World War III. What is God doing? He's fulfilling his word. He's fulfilling his promise. Before the world even got started, in Genesis 2:17, what did he say? You shall surely die. If you do what? If you eat of the fruit, you shall surely die. You're going to die. You're going to lose your life. Now, when you look back and you go, man, he fulfilled his word. He ain't playing. No, Cain came out. And who was Cain? Cain is, you know, this in me, when I look at the story of Cain and Abel, I look at the story of Satan and Christ. Satan had something against the Christ, right? Cain had something against his brother. Right? Cain had something against his brother. What did Cain have against his brother? His brother, let's read the story of Cain and Abel real quickly here. Right? Christians and unbelievers. What do the Christians have it on the unbelievers? That they're being persecuted. Right? What does the scripture says here about Cain and Abel? The story of Cain and Abel is the story of life. Right? Cain told Abel, his brother, And it came about when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and killed him. Cain rose up against Abel and killed him in the field. Now take this story here of Genesis 4:8 and multiply it by a million billion times. That's every murder, right? I watch Escape every night. And what do you see on Escape? It takes a killer, American Greed, right? And all of these other shows. Why? Because Cain is killing Abel for money. Cain is killing Abel for land. Cain is killing Abel for women. King David rose up and killed Uriah for his wife, right? Ahab and his wife Jezebel killed Naboth for their land. Israel rose up and killed seven nations for their land. What? According to the scriptures, Joshua led them on a conquest, and seven nations who were idolatrous, immoral, evil, wretched, practicing all forms of evil, Satan worship, God used Israel to wipe them out, just like the Chaldeans were used to wipe Israel out for what? Practicing idolatry. Cain killed Abel. So when you come into the New Testament, who is Cain and who is Abel? Christ is Abel and doing his Father's work, and the Father comes out and says, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." Satan sees that and he right? And what does he do to the Christ? He uses one of his disciples to kill him. The disciple that was invited up to the Mount of Transfiguration, Judas Iscariot, and who was always constantly, you know, pilfering the money box, was the one that he used. Was the one that Satan used to do what? To betray the Christ, to lead him to his death. So Satan took the same position as Cain. And you know what I think? I think that the spirit of Satan entered Cain, right? The same way the spirit of Satan entered the woman Eve, or influenced the woman Eve. And Eve influenced Adam. Adam, being that he gave Adam's seed that had been tainted, going into the woman, giving birth to Cain. Cain becoming, now manifesting what? The hatred of Satan. Cain manifesting the spirit of Satan. Came manifesting the violence that was in Satan. But where did it come from? It came from his father, who disobeyed, and who came from his wife. And his wife had been influenced by who? By Satan. So Satan influences the woman. She influences Adam. Adam goes into her. And being that he was corrupted and she was corrupted, they give birth to Cain. Cain manifests the violence and the hate and the sin of the devil. We come into the New Testament, and it's the same thing. We come into American history, Cain is killed, Cain kills Abel, right? Throughout the whole human race, from beginning to end, Cain is killing Abel. We come into the Christian church, who is the Lord pleased with? Well, he's supposed to be pleased with the Son, and we are his body. We are the people who have repented of our sins, confessed our sins, trusted him for the forgiveness of sins, made our abode with God. And so what is the world's response against us as a result? They hate us. Jesus says in John 17, actually not in John 17, but in other passages of John, he says, they hated me before they hated you. Why? Well, we didn't do nothing. But resentment, right? Cain resented his brother and killed him. Satan resented the woman Eve and misled her. And you know, the whole ordeal. Satan hated Jesus and led who? One of his disciples to betray. We hate them. These people were hated because of what God had given to them. And the Africans were hated and led to their... So, over and over and over, we see this pattern of ungodliness and evil repeated throughout Scripture, right? So we see the derision, the mockery. We see the delay. God is taking too much time. And then we see the dissolution, right? We see the dissolution in verses 10 through 13. That is the destruction. So Peter says, but the day of the Lord will come like a thief. Do you expect a thief to come? No. Well, if you knew the thief was coming, you'd put your jewelry out. You know, put out the china and put out the goblets, put out everything. Why? Because they're coming here to steal it. They must really need it. Well, we'll keep it out so that we don't get killed. We'll put it right outside the door. We'll put the jewelry box outside, and we'll put the china outside. We'll even give them the key to our bank boxes. You know, put it all outside on the front door. Save them the trouble of breaking the windows. Save them the trouble of slitting our throat. Put it right outside so they can just take it. Go, get out of here. We don't need it. That's why the Lord says, do not love the world nor the things in the world, right? I wrote here on the board, this is a different sermon, but it says, you know, are you blessed? Or are you waiting for the whole aspect of blessing? Solomon was blessed, right? Solomon was blessed. I wrote here, are you blessed? Or are you waiting are you waiting to cash in on someone else's blessing to get your portion? I wrote this right here. Are you blessed, or are you waiting to cash in on someone else's blessing to get your portion? Here is King Solomon, who was blessed in 1 Kings 3:11 through 15, but then in Ecclesiastes 1, 2 through 3, through chapter 2, verse 26, what does Solomon say? It's all what? Meaningless. All of this blessing, all of this riches, meaningless. And then in Philippians 3, 8, what does Paul say? What was Paul's blessing? He says, I lost all things for the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. Right? So when we look here at verse 10, it says, but the day of the Lord will come like a thief. So the thief is waiting to cash in on your blessing. The thief is waiting to cash in on your blessing, right? To get his portion. So whether we're as rich as Solomon or as poor as Paul, right? The portion of the Christian faith is what? Christ. Look at what it says. The day of the Lord will come like a thief, in which the heavens will pass away with a roar. Remember, the scripture says in verse 7 here that the heavens are being preserved. The heavens and the earth are by his word are being reserved for fire. And then in verse 10 he says, the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the elements will be destroyed with intense heat, and the earth and its works will be burned up. This is what he was talking about. This is the second judgment that's coming with the second coming of Christ. He says, since all these things are to be destroyed in this day, in this way, what sort of people ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness? But the world is not going to receive us as a godly people, because the world doesn't want, you know, we're the world is Cain, and the church is Abel, right? The world is Cain's world, Satan's world, and the church is Abel, and Israel is divided. Scripture says, not all Israel is Israel, right? From the very, very beginning, Israel was divided. Even in the days of Moses, Israel was divided. So the scripture says here, verse 12, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God, on account of which the heavens will be destroyed by burning and the elements will melt with intense heat. So you Christians need to be looking for the hastening of the coming of the day of the Lord. And remember, in Matthew 24, Jesus describes the coming of his second coming. You need to read that. You go into Daniel chapter 11. Daniel talks about what was spoken to him about the second coming, right? When you look at Paul's letter to the Thessalonians, he talks about the second coming. I think it's 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, right? Thessalonians chapter 2. He talks about the second coming of Christ. And then it says in verse 13, but according to his promise, we are looking for a new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. So here Peter sums it all up and repeats what John says. There's a new heaven and a new earth that's coming, right? So it first century Christians preparing us for the end times. So the dissolution here, right? The dissolution is the destruction that's coming in the end times, the day of the Lord, the day of his coming. Also, in that time, there will be the man of lawlessness, right? Who will be standing in the temple and who will be declaring himself to be God. And basically, that's what's going to bring about a lot of the destruction and the misery for the Christian church, and misery for Israel, and misery for the Gentiles, the ungodly. So we see that destruction is coming in the future, right? So Peter prepares these Christians. Right? He tells them that false prophets and false teachers are coming. He tells them, if you're a Christian, stay strong. If you're a weak Christian, you better be assured. He tells them that the word of God, right? He says, like newborn babes, long for the pure milk of the word. And then he says, now I'm more assured because I have heard the word. I have heard the voice of the Father. And scripture is not of one's own prophecy, but it's man moved by the Holy Spirit who spoke from God. So here in this third chapter, He prepares them for the mockery that's coming. He prepares them for the hindrance, the delay, right? We think that he's not coming, but what? 1,000 years for us is a day for him. And then he tells us about the destruction of the heavens and the earth. Have you ever seen the movie of Sodom and Gomorrah, where the whole city is torched? Okay, think of the whole world being torched, right? Think of a forest fire out in California, the whole thing just engulfed. You've seen houses engulfed. Now try all of the houses of all the neighborhoods. And then he tells them in chapter 3, verses 14 through 18, diligence, right? He says to them, therefore, now as a result of all of this, beloved, since you look for these things, be diligent to be found by him in peace, spotlessness, and blameless, right? In verse 11, he says, since all these things are to be destroyed in this way, what sort of people ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness? And in verse 14, he says, this is the sort of people you are to be. You are to be a people of peace, spotlessness, and blamelessness. And in verse 15, he says, and regard the patience of our Lord to be what? Salvation. The patience of our Lord. Going back to verse 10, right? Actually, going back to verse 8, the delay there. What is that delay? The delay is the intention of the Lord is that he's being patient with us, right? He's being patient with man because of our salvation. Because once the heavens and the earth are torched and the souls of men are burned and judgment is carried out for the murder of these and the murder of these, right? That's it. So he says, in regard the patience of our Lord to be salvation, the reason why it's taking so long is because God throughout the ages is doing right. He's waiting for man. He's got to deal with man in hell right now, right? In that place of torment. And he's preached the gospel to them. Remember, we read that in 1 Peter, that he went and preached the gospel to the spirits, right? So the Lord went and preached the gospel to the spirits, and he told them, right? He told those people about his salvation. And I'm sure some people received it. But now he says, and regard the patience of our Lord to be salvation, just as our beloved brother Paul, according to the wisdom given him, wrote to you. And now he's making reference to Paul, and he says, look, now he's an equal teacher. Paul is an equal teacher. Remember, he made mention of this in his writing to you. Now, he didn't say specifically which writing and which letter. You know, we can probably read Paul's letters and find what Peter was talking about. We know that Peter's writing is a sort of like a duplicate of Jude, the book of Jude. And we know that word for word, Jude probably was quoting Peter when he wrote that letter, right? And it says, in regard the patience of our Lord, the Lord is being patient here, just as our beloved brother Paul, according to the wisdom given him, wrote to you. Both of those men had issues. Peter was the fisherman who was hungry for money. Paul was the Saul, right? He was hungry for the blood of the Christians. And now both of them are on the Lord's side. And he says, remember, Paul had written to you based on the wisdom given to him. And verse 16 says, as also in all of his letters, speaking in them of these things. What things? The things that he just talked about, right? The derision, the delay, the dissolution, right? Paul made mention of all of this stuff, the mockery, the ridicule, the beatings that he had gotten, and letters to Corinthians, letters to, my God, Thessalonians, in all of the churches that he's written. He's made mention of these things. He says, as also in all his letters, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to understand, which the untaught and unstable distort, right? And Peter, who best would know than Peter, who was untaught and who was unstable and distorted in his thinking, right? And he says, as they do also the rest of the scriptures, to their own destruction. So Peter recognized in himself that he was a learned man, but also in others, that they had not been trained in the thinking and the teachings of the Old Testament prophets. So they distorted the understanding of the scriptures, right? They distorted the teaching. That's why they were false teachers, right? He makes reference now to false teachers again in the Old Testament and the New Testament. That's why he says they distort. They were unstable, you know, untaught and unstable. They distort as they do also the rest of the scriptures. So whenever they read Paul, they didn't understand in which context Paul was talking from, so they distorted what Paul was saying. They didn't understand the prophets, and they didn't keep it within the context of Holy Scripture. They took it out of context, they misquoted, and they didn't understand, and so they didn't understand Paul. And this was to their own destruction, right? Verse 17 and 18, right? It says, "You therefore, beloved, knowing this beforehand, be on your guard," right? Be on your guard, right? Be on your guard. "Lest being carried away by the error of unprincipled men, you fall from your own steadfastness." So he tells them to cover themselves, right? Be ready to defend yourself, right? Be on your guard. Because if you're not, you're going to be carried away by the errors of unprincipled men. Again, he's making reference to ungodly men. He's making reference to ungodly teachers, ungodly prophets, false teachers, false prophets. And if you're not on your guard, you will fall from your own steadfastness. You will fall from your own diligence. You will fall from your own effort if you're not careful. And then he says in verse 18, "But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ." Grow, that's what Peter was trying to tell them in the first chapter. To grow, right? Remember in the first chapter when he says to them, "Putting aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisy and envy and slander, like newborn babes, long for the pure milk of the word, that by it you may grow in salvation." The growth that he's talking about is we found in chapter 2, verse 18. He says, grow where? He says, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Grow all three tribes, including the Europeans. Christians, you need to grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because of the patience of our Lord of salvation. He's being patient with us. He's being patient with the Africans and their sins. He's being patient with the Native Americans and their sin. He's being patient with the Jews and their sin. He's being patient with the Europeans and their sin. Why is he being patient? Because he does not want any to perish, but have everlasting life. So he says, but grow in the grace and knowledge. What is the grace? For by grace we have been saved. And the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Why? Paul says, I've lost all things for the surpassing value of knowing Christ. I've lost everything. I lost all my land. I lost all my family. I lost all my people. I lost all of my tribe. I lost. What? For the surpassing. Christ is that important. That important? Are you sure? Yes. More important than life itself. For it's from him we live and we move and we have our being. Jesus says, apart from me, you can do nothing. Right? In the Gospel of John, I think it's in chapter 15, verse 5. Apart from me, you can do nothing. The most important person, thing, place, breath. I am your breath. I'm the breath on your mouth. What are you talking about? So more than anything else on the whole planet and existing in itself, you want meaning in your life? You know why your life is meaningless? Because you don't have Jesus. If you had Jesus, you would be his church. Right? You would be his church. If you had Jesus, you would be his church. And as his church, you don't need land. As his church, you don't need the freedom. What freedom? I'm free because I know God. My master needs freedom because he's a slave to money. My master needs freedom because he's a slave to sex. My master needs freedom because he's gay and he can't live without that. My master needs freedom because he needs land, extra land, more land, cotton land. He needs this. No, I'm not the, I have Jesus. My master needs. So you may say, my mom needs Jesus. She's a tycoon. My dad needs Jesus because he's a filthy oil rich. My government needs Jesus because they feel they have to every nation and every tribe. My family needs Jesus because we wear the hat. My fiance needs Jesus. My wife needs Jesus. My kids need Jesus. Whatever your story is, right? And that's why Jesus says, go into all the world and make disciples of all nations, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. And then in verse 18, he says, to him be the glory, both now and to the day of eternity. Amen. Why did these disciples need Jesus? Because it is to him be glory. There's no other name under heaven by which men are to be saved. Right? Now, you're going to hear that Kevin fell, Kevin stumbled. No, Kevin became all things to all men, so that he may wince and he may assure the people that he stumbled with, he went into an idol's temple, he ate with them, and then he came back out and started preaching again. What a hypocrite. No, God is a forgiving God. He can forgive you of your idolatry. He can forgive you of your eating the flesh of the, you know, of animals that were sacrificed to temple gods. He can forgive you of your immorality. He can forgive you of your butchery. He can forgive you of your idolatry. He can forgive you of whatever the issue is. He can forgive you for it. And he wants you to continue to grow in the knowledge of his grace for all eternity. Right? So it's not just a one-day thing. It's all eternity. You want meaning of life now? It's Jesus. Because the Jesus that you know now is the Jesus you're going to know in eternity for eternity. And it's the same Jesus that has been known throughout eternity. Whether you call him Yahweh, whether you call him the Son of Man, the Son of God, right? The King of Israel, whatever name, you know, whatever name you know him by in here, right? I am Emmanuel, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Prince of Peace, the Everlasting Father, Son of God, Son of Man. So the scripture says, to him be the glory, both now and to the day of eternity. From eternity, through eternity, to eternity, for all eternity. So I'm going to go ahead and end this. We're going to end 2 Peter. And I want to invite them to be born again. Invite my own people to be born again. Invite the Jews, right? Israel, who may not know Christ, to be born again. And invite the government to be born again. Invite Grace Community Church, elder board, leaders, masters, who may not be saved. Because the scripture says there are false teachers, right? I'm going to invite my own Haitian family, right, to be born again. The Franklin family that I've been harping about online to be born again. I want to invite you Americans, whichever side you fall on, whether you're with this hit or without the hit, you know, with the church, without the church, now is the time for salvation. Right, now is the time to be born again. Right? Maybe this is the reason why God has me here instead of in some big, huge group of people, you know, in a stadium somewhere. Maybe God, you know, God has diminished his ministry to just one single person and to say, hey, let's talk this way so that everybody who gets an opportunity to see this video can make their own personal. Because remember what he says in Matthew, right? In Matthew, what does he say? You know, I'm sorry, I can't go live on you. I wish I could. You know, where you could talk to me, I could talk to you. But, you know, Matthew, in Matthew's gospel, he says, when you want to pray, you don't pray out in front of everybody, you know, in front of 10 million people, everybody's watching you on TV. No, you go into your inner closet and you pray, our Father, who art in heaven. And then you deal with your issue of salvation. You deal with your issue of, you know, the meaningless of life. Why am I here? Why did you create me? Why did you make me so big, so small, so poor, so rich, so skinny, so big, you know, large, or whatever your issue is, so dark, so light, so beautiful, or you know, whatever your issue is with God, so sick, you know, so, you know, effeminate, however the issue is. And in that process, he wants you to understand who he was in the past, who he is in the present, and who's going to be in the future, and who he's going to be in all eternity. So he invites you to salvation so you can understand who he was, who he is, and who he's going to be, what he's going to do. You know, and maybe you need this private video to talk with your Heavenly Father. You know, close your eyes and grab a Bible and read the text. Go and get all of the other videos of 1 Peter and other videos that I've put out there, and try to understand, not me, but God, what he's saying to you in these videos and through his word. So I finally got a transcriber, and I'm going to try to put it all in words, in writing, if God allows it, and try to publish it sometime in the future, Lord willing. When you see it, buy it. You know, buy the book. And I don't know when it's going to be. It could be now or 2 years from now. Hopefully, it won't be 2 years from now, but, you know, the Lord works in mysterious ways. If you want to know more about the Lord, you know, just go online, and I have some videos, and you can buy the book, Let's Talk About God. You can also buy Spiritual Convictions Pertaining to the Christian Faith, or Ephesians, right? The letter, commentary on Ephesians. This is all for you, Christian, and this is also for you who are searching to know the Lord. And those of you who are not interested, and you're part of the ungodly, and you're part of the mockery, and you're part of, you know, the hindrance, and you're mocking and ridiculing, and you don't care, and I would pity you and say, you know, you shouldn't do that, because life was a gift to you, and you should take it into consideration. And consider the blessing, not the blessing of the world, the blessing of millions, which Solomon got, but the blessing of Christ, right? Because at some point before you die, like Paul says, I have lost all things. He's saying what while he's living, but we say it in the casket. I've lost all things. I've lost my life, and I have to leave it all behind. Paul is doing it while he's standing, and he says, I lost everything to know Christ. What's holding you back from losing everything to know Christ? Okay, you lost everything, but are you willing to know Christ? We lost Africa. Are we willing to know Christ? Right? We lost Africa. Are we willing to know Christ? So while you stand there with all your billions and all your millions and all your certificates of, look at all the land I've purchased, you know, are you willing to lose it for Christ while you're standing? Not when you're in the grave, but when you're standing. So that God can reward you later on. Because the rich man, when he comes into the kingdom, or the rich man, when he comes, that's why I think this is my last point. But in Luke 16, that's why, compare Luke 16, the rich man in Luke 16, with what Paul has says in Philippians 3:8, right? In the rich man in Luke 16 wouldn't even feed Lazarus the crumbs that came from his mouth. Right? He was filthy rich, all of this money. He wouldn't even feed Lazarus. He wouldn't feed Lazarus. Not even with the crumbs. So when he died, God would not receive him, but sent him to Hades, a place of torment, because of his selfishness. But instead, he put Lazarus in that place to comfort him for all the misery and all the pain that he suffered. So you, the rich, who stand today with all your billions and your trillions and your millions and your land and your... Are you willing, and I know you're not, are you willing to give all of that up like Solomon, who in Ecclesiastes says, meaningless, worthless, right, for the knowledge of Christ, right? Are you willing to give it up while you stand? Not when you're dead, because when you're dead, you're going to be just like the rich man, right? When you're dead, you're going to be like the rich man, and he said, depart from me, I never knew. The most important thing to you was the millions and the billions, and now... This kingdom here is not a million and billion dollar kingdom. It's a divine kingdom that you cannot buy your ticket into. Your jewelry, your billions, your gold, your all the land you've had and all the millions and trillions that you have, it can't get you into this kingdom. Because this kingdom is a divine kingdom, ruled and created by a divine king. And so it's not one, and there's gold and silver and all of that up there. Lapis lazuli, and ooh, but it's not for your kind of gold. It's not for your kind of jewels. It's divine jewels for those who are faithful. Jesus says, if you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father who was in heaven, who is in heaven. So it's a different kind of riches and glory, right? But you're not, since you weren't willing to wait for it, sorry, can't let you in. You got to go in with the rich man in Hades. And believe me, it's not a party. Father, I pray for all those who will be watching this video. And Father, I pray that as long as the video is online, that you will allow the people that you have chosen to watch this video to take the words from the video and to apply to their lives. I pray, Father, that you will open the mind of the unbelieving, and you will restore the saints who are weak in faith, and you will continue to strengthen the churches in Asia Minor, and you will continue to strengthen the churches that are here in Portland, in the West Coast, in Seattle, in Los Angeles, and all over the world. I pray that these people will remember that life in itself, the meaning of life, is in knowing you, like Solomon says in Ecclesiastes 12, the last two verses. I pray, Lord God, that they will stand with Paul, whom they had shunned, that is the Jews, and that they will come to a saving knowledge of you, Jesus. May you bless the remainder of this day. May you bless this ministry. May you bless this teaching. May you turn the false prophets and the false teachers to becoming true prophets and true teachers in this generation and the generation to come. May you prepare the hearts of the saints for the coming of the Antichrist so that they know how to properly respond when they see him, when they know of him. May you prepare the church for the millennial kingdom. And may you use this video, Lord God, to remind the church of the sort of people that they ought to be. A people of peace and righteousness and godliness. A people not going back to the vomit. And when they stumble, and they will stumble, because I know I will, we will all fall, and we will all fall flat on our faces. Let us be a repentant people, and let us, like David in Psalms 32, repent of our sins, dust ourselves off. Like Solomon says, the righteous man falls seven times, but in the end, he gets up and he cleans himself off. And then, Lord God, he continues, he repents, and sanctifies himself in Christ again. May your Holy Spirit descend and fall upon those who believe, and convict those who do not believe. In Jesus' name, amen. Therefore, this ends the series on Peter, 1st and 2nd Peter. And I hope that God gives me another opportunity to share his word with you. Maybe Paul or James or maybe another gospel. Not sure yet where he's going to lead me. Summer is coming. Hope to see you out there. As you know, I was raising funds while I'm on the subject. I was raising funds for a household of faith. See, this is why I needed the funds when I was out there. It was because I wanted to get out of the streets of Portland, and I wanted to get out of my own house so that I can take the teaching of the scriptures and give you your own house. And so you could come and worship with me. The house here is so small that you know, and this is basically the sign that I had out there, right? This is the sign that I wanted to use to say to you, you know, I was raising funds for a new church building, and I wanted to raise $10,000. But you know what? I apologize, and I apologize to the realtors, because you know what happens is that there's a trailer out at the Pioneer Square right now, and the trailer, I called up that number, and they told me that they had a 10 by 30, I think it was, or 10 by 40, I'm not exactly sure, and or 12 by 30, and when I asked them how much it was for, they said it was for $45,000 for a property that's 10 or 12 by 40, right? And it has an office in there, but there's no bathroom. $45,000. So there would be a space where there's an office, and then the rest of it would be used for worship and maybe a classroom. $45,000. And this is without even a restroom or a kitchen with a sink. So I thought, goodness, you know, and here I'm only advertising and asking for $10,000. And remember, the scripture says in Exodus 25, they raised the contribution. In Exodus 35, they raised the contribution. Now, this was back in Christmas time, and when the new year was about to turn. So this was like 5-6 weeks ago. And I haven't been out there since then, right? And so I'm still the Church of Portland. And of course, if God is putting it in your heart, you know, to give, you know, this is what you'd be giving to this ministry, this teaching, not just the teaching that I do outside, but taking that teaching from outside to putting it inside, and you know, teaching the Bible verse by verse, gathering the scattered saints. That is you. That's out there. That's walking in circles, looking for a place to worship, and then winning the loss for Christ, making disciples of the nations. You know, and 2 Corinthians 9:7 says, "Be a cheerful giver." So don't be afraid to give, and don't be afraid to give cheerfully, because God in Christ is calling you to give. To give to what? To a new household of faith, and to the teaching of His Word. Because remember, the Scripture says the worker is worthy of his wages, right? And we are supposed to get double honor. And the Scripture says that those who preach the gospel get their living from the gospel. But I like to take all that giving and put it in toward a house, so that you and I could meet together as a family of God, and prepare ourselves and prepare the future Christians of what is to come with our teaching of the Word. Anyway, at some point or another, we have to push aside the issues of the world and to take on the issues of the Christian life, to push aside the sins of the world and to take on the salvation and all the and all that God has in store for us as a Christian church, and as individual Christians who come together to give, to learn, to make disciples, to be whatever it is that God is calling you to be. So I'm going to go ahead and let you go, and hopefully tackle this transcriber to see what the problem is, so that we can have a book and I can put it in store, and maybe some of you will purchase it, and maybe some of you will teach what I taught, right? Teach it to your friends, your family, and whoever is in your life that may need this teaching. God bless.